We are honored and excited to win a Technology and Engineering Emmy for our work with DirecTV and El Segundo, really creating a better way for advertisers to run campaigns using the addressable technology at the local level. We've enabled addressable insertion with our partners in the local cable interconnect. So, you know, what does that mean? What goes behind that? You know, really, when AT&T acquired DirecTV in 2015, we had a collective goal to unlock greater advertising synergies through participation in the local market interconnect. This model aligns basically all MVPDs and the DMAs to execute advertising identically across all participants, thereby providing the best inner DMA reach and value. And this effort has proven to be wildly successful and profitable for our business. I do want to say congrats to all the honorees who demonstrated excellence in engineering creativity. We've all materially improved kind of the existing methods of the TV business for the benefit of national cable. But I do really want to give credit to those AT&T and the cable interconnect partners. And I say that because I think what was done here is unique and it's not easy. When you have major media conglomerates like we're recognized and honored here that have come together despite being fierce competitors in the attention economy to create a solution using the addressable technology to benefit the client, to benefit the local advertiser, that's an important and material thing. And we believe all, you know, all boats rise with the tide. Easy to say, hard to do. And certainly this group has done that. What I think is really interesting from my perspective, Andy, is that, you know, if we learned anything from the election, the past election, it's that every market is different. Every zip code, every city, every county is different. And the addressable technology allows us to reach those local buyers. And again, they have their own unique aspects there. And because of that, they know the regions, they're able to maximize the value, and we're happy to utilize that technology to get it in their hands. And finally, listen, as far as our business, we've made a ton of progress since we've gotten together previously. We've gone through a big integration here in the fall, and we're looking forward to a strong 2021.
Matt, so tell us what's happening with WarnerMedia and sort of how things have changed for you and operationally, what it all means.
Yeah, listen, it's been great. You're aware AT&T acquired Time Warner in 2018 and then renamed to WarnerMedia. We've been working through integration plans, you know, late summer through the fall, and have kind of unified the best of what is WarnerMedia ad sales to try to create better solutions for our clients. And so, listen, while we've been working together with WarnerMedia for a very long time, you know, glad to see that come together more officially. You know, our sweet spot has been historically monetizing the 2 minutes of MVPD inventory and doing that through a ton of innovation, data-driven, addressable, and digital, et cetera. I think what you're going to see with us now, part of the WarnerMedia family, is that we're perfectly positioned to really avail more inventory to marketers across all screens and devices and really innovating around the content and the delivery and the monetization. I think we've got the same mindset as WarnerMedia, right? We want to drive insights and outcomes that matter to advertisers. I don't think that's going to change. What I get most excited about is the opportunity we have to really unlock custom creative and content from WarnerMedia's award-winning studios to try to develop personalized messaging, branded content, and use the precision of addressable to help distribute that footprint. But listen, if I take a step back, I would tell you we've done a lot with addressable since the last time that we've gotten together. We've expanded the footprint. We've gone from linear to digital and include kind of a consolidated offering. We're looking at CTV inventory across third parties. Our goals have not changed, right? We've always been focused on providing for our clients unduplicated reach, streamlined execution, and attribution for the addressable campaigns that we run. We want to help automate that end state. We want to get that process between advertiser, programmer, and MVPD in harmony. And we want to improve the delivery of those ads.
So what are some challenges that exist? You know, buying addressable, it's very valuable. There's different price equations, of course, as we know. There's different platforms for it. And to some degree, in some instances, limited inventory. What are challenges and where do you hope it goes?
Yeah, it's a great question. You know, you're right. You know, marketers have told us they want unduplicated reach. They've told us they want a full campaign across all their media mix. They told us, and they continue to tell us, audience insights across the screens and attribution and advanced analytics. And they want to measure it all effectively and they want it very cost effective. That's a long task. And when I think about the challenges that are facing Addressable, I'm actually really excited because I think we're really at an interesting point in time. Listen, why is there challenges? I think there's a lot from an ecosystem perspective. The speed at which technology is changing is hard. Marrying legacy linear technology to emerging digital technology is hard. Creating the business rules across those platforms is difficult, right? The fragmentation of media services is real. The fragmentation of engagement is real. Ad fatigue is real. Measurement in this particular product and category is emerging. I think that in the past for Addressable, there has been connotations that it's either super expensive or it's not scalable, but that's really changed. I think overall, we've moved out of the test budget phase. We sit with these major brands. This is a major part of their media strategies today. I think honestly, Andy, I don't think anybody has covered it from all sides, maybe more than you or better than you over the years. I think you understand the Addressable technology. Yes, it helps minimize waste. Yes, it helps reach precise audiences. But I think the use cases in the last few years have really changed. They've really evolved. I think there's a lot of innovative Addressable work being done around reach and frequency management through technology, you know, trying to reach those hard light TV viewers, those infrequent watchers. I think you've seen, despite ratings decline, Addressable has proven to give advertisers the opportunity to better reach their audiences. It's allowed advertisers to more evenly distribute their impressions against the linear TV schedule, and all while bringing down the effective cost, right, of those deals. I think on the Addressable side, it continues to resonate with categories from CPG to insurance to, you know, even wider audiences looking at that funnel. In general, and it obviously depends on category, we're seeing lift around plus 5% for audiences looking to leverage these Addressable capabilities to reach their audiences. That all that is great news. So I get that there's some challenges from the buy side. I would say we're very optimistic. I think you look at eMarketer, a $3 billion ad spend expected in Addressable TV this year, growing to $3.7 billion next year. Listen, TV, you know, ad spend is flat, right? But there are some really exciting, interesting opportunities within TV, and the Addressable piece is, I think, a big part of that.